Grace and peace to you. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice in the rain that is falling and be glad in it. I have just a few announcements for you, and most of them are for weeks coming up, not actually this week. The first is a reminder or an announcement that in October, on Wednesday evenings, those first four Wednesdays in October, we are going to gather for what will feel very similar to our Lenten suppers. We're going to gather for some fellowship, for some good food. We're going to gather for song and for some time of reflection and prayer and lots more food and fellowship. So, on the first Wednesday of October, come and join us at 6 p.m. That night will be a taco bar, and we'll announce each one, but we're going to do bar food. Taco bar, potato bar, salad, no. You can have salad if you want, but pasta bar, lots of good food, lots of good fellowship. There will be some sign-up sheets throughout the time that we are doing this, but not as much as you are used to, because some of our committees and some of our groups in the church are actually going to take the lead on some of these meals. The other announcement I have is that in the back there is a sign-up sheet for Trunk or Treat. Now, I am aware it is only September. But I am also aware that it is almost October, whether you realize it or not, and today is the first day of fall. We need 8 vehicles and or participants to make Trunk or Treat go. And so we need to know in advance that you intend to participate, not day of. So if you are planning to participate or if you're thinking about it, would you sign up on the sign-up sheet? Are there other announcements? Yes, Darlene.
We have a couple of birthdays.
We have a couple of birthdays. Okay.
And
Debbie's sitting in the back.
Okay. And Cheryl.
And Cheryl. Okay. It's September. There are lots of birthdays. How about everybody? People of God, let us join our hearts and worship our God together.
I think we're ready now, I hope. I'm in hiding this morning, so we'll do it from here. Let us all join together in our call to worship. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff. They comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Lord Jesus Christ, our good shepherd, you give us new birth in the waters of baptism. You anoint us with oil, and you nourish us at your table with heavenly food. In your goodness and mercy, dispel the shadows of evil and death, and lead us along safe paths, that we may rest securely in you and dwell in the house of the Lord, now and forever. Amen. Opening hymn this morning is number 361 in the hymnal, O Christ, the great foundation. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their way and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them return to the Lord that he may have mercy on them, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. Trusting ourselves to the grace of God, let us confess our sins. Merciful God, you forgive all who truly repent and turn to you. We humbly confess our sins and ask your mercy. We have not loved you with a pure heart, nor have we loved our neighbor as ourselves. We have not done justice, loved kindness, or walked humbly with you. Have mercy on us, O God, in your loving kindness. In your great compassion, cleanse us from our sin. Create in us a new heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within us. Do not cast us from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from us. Return to us the joy of your salvation and sustain us with your bountiful spirit through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Jesus said, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid." We place our trust in the one who loves us and assures us that we are a forgiven people.
We are assured that we are a forgiven people. Whatever you have done or not done, whatever it is that you carry that you cannot let go, Christ has already set us free. In that freedom, we are given peace, and we are sent to offer that peace. And so would you take time to offer Christ's peace to one another? The peace of Christ be with you.
Our first reading this morning comes to us from the book of Isaiah, the 11th chapter, starting at verse 1. A shoot shall come out from the stump of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. His delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see, or decide by what his ears hear, but with righteousness he shall judge the poor, and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall kill the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt around the waist, and faithfulness the belt around his loins. The wolf shall live with the lamb. The leopard shall lie down with the kid. The calf and the lion and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze. Their young shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. The nursing child shall play over the hole of the asp. And the weaned child shall put his hand on the adder's den. They will not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain, for the earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The way my Savior leads me, cheers each winding path that treads, gives me strength for every trial, feeds me with the living bread. You lead me and keep
Our second reading comes from Philippians chapter 4. Hear the word of God. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We are walking our way verse by verse through the 23rd Psalm. Today we reflect, you let me rest in fields of green grass. You lead me to streams of peaceful water. You refresh my life. That is one of the translations. What is it like to be fully at rest, to be fully restored, completely at peace? What does it feel like to have such trust in God that you know, I mean really know, that there is no need to worry, no need to be concerned about anything at all? What would it be like to sit in the presence of God beside still waters and to have your soul completely refreshed? It's okay. I don't know either. There are times in my life that I have felt refreshed and revived. I have felt that sense of exhaustion at the end of a day, that you can take a deep breath and know that you worked well and that your body and your mind are tired because you did good work. I have sometimes felt that sense of peace and rest wash over me when I am still and letting someone else worry about things. When I've taken time away and really and intentionally paid attention to God, I've had moments in my life where I know, contrary to all other evidence, that it's going to be okay. That God is in control, and even though everything else seems to be falling apart, it will be okay, even though I can't prove it. There are times that I've even felt at peace in myself. That sense of peace that can't be explained by anything except God's Spirit has to be involved, because there's no good reason for that sense of peace. But to live in absolute peace, to live really knowing God's peace all the time, that eludes me. Maybe it's because I'm busy. Maybe I have too much on my plate. Maybe I don't really trust God enough. Maybe it's because I am sinful. Maybe it's because I'm broken. Maybe it's because I'm not as receptive to God as I should be. Any of those sound familiar to you? When have you experienced that sense of peace? Do you know what it feels like, even for a brief, fleeting moment, to just take a deep breath and to know that it is okay, whatever it is, to have that moment of confidence and trust in Christ? Do you wonder why it's so fleeting some days? Why it's here and gone? My suspicion is that it has far more to do with us than it does with God, because I suspect that the significance is in our ability to remain paying attention and remain present than it is whether God is here or not, because I truly do believe God is already here and present. Reading this particular verse of Psalm 23, it is clear that the Good Shepherd, our God, longs to provide green grass and cool water That is nourishment and refreshment. The psalmist describes that God longs to restore our very souls. All of this suggests an intentional but leisurely life with God. It all suggests something that is not lazy, but is well rested and well provided for. A life free of rushing anxiety and fear that so many of us experience. A life where reliance upon the goodness and the provision of God takes over. A life that is free of hurry and rushing around or panic. A life centered on Christ. This would be a life of peace. That is shalom. Shalom is a Hebrew word, and it means peace, but not peace. It means wholeness. Shalom means fullness and completeness. Shalom is not just about an end to battles and war and conflict, though wouldn't that be wonderful? Shalom is about wholeness of a person and a place and a people. Shalom is about the wholeness of the mind, the body, the soul together as one, not separate, sparring pieces of ourselves. Shalom is no mere end to war, though it would be a great start. Shalom is a coming of the very kingdom of God among us. Shalom is the restoration of God's rule over creation. An end to the rebellion of it is full and complete healing not of the people, but of the land. It is what Isaiah described. The wolf shall live with the lamb, the leopard lie down with the kid, the calf, the lion, and the fatling together, and a little child will lead them. For the earth will be so full of the knowledge of God, it will be the same as the waters that cover the sea. This is the kingdom of God. This is the world as God intends. This is what Jesus came to bring. Reconciliation, restoration, recreation, shalom. Sounds amazing and really far away, doesn't it? We long for this. We love these images. I adore this passage in Isaiah, this idea, this vision of the kingdom. And on our very best days, we desire this, and we even want to work for it. But there's all sorts of strife around us and in us. God's kingdom has certainly not fully come, but that doesn't mean that we are left in despair. It doesn't mean that the Good Shepherd isn't present. In fact, what is given to us in Psalm 23 is the here and now glimpse of what could be and what will be. It is a vision of what will be in the days when God's shalom has fully come. And even more than that, we are bearers of God's shalom. We are the people who carry God's peace, this wholeness, because we are given access through to the very presence of God. This is the glimpse of what God wants for us, and we are the ones who have it to share, to tell the world about it. When Christ has fully come, and to tell somebody else about it. Jesus is risen. death and mourning and crying will be no more, we are the ones who are told to go and tell the world that that is true, that it is possible. So how? How do we do that in this mess of a world? How do we do that in the chaos that is in our own minds, let alone the chaos out there, the conflict that we see in ourselves and between ourselves, let alone in the world? Well, Paul gives us something to try on for size. Rejoice in the Lord always. Don't worry about anything, but in everything, with prayer and supplication, take all of those requests that you have to God. And then, whatever is true and honorable and just and pleasing and commendable and excellent, anything worthy of praise, think about those things. We spend so much time and energy and effort thinking about everything that is wrong, focusing on everything that is bad, focusing on everything that is broken. And God says, look at what is joyful and beautiful and a gift and whole already. Keep on doing the things you have learned, Paul says. All of the things that you have already received and heard and seen, focus on what you have and what God has given you, and the God of peace will be with you. Do you see how these practices, intentionally taking on gentleness and humility and rejoicing in God's good work, trusting in God in prayer, seeking to do the will of God for you and me, do you see how that might share a glimpse of God's kingdom with other people? Do you see how it might be about living as if we were already in the kingdom, not just waiting around for it to come to us? You see, to live as a people beside the still waters, receiving the good green grass, is about intentionality. It is about choosing to receive what God longs to give us. It is about being willing to live as if God were our provider, rather than hustling to do it for ourselves. All of this looks really good on paper. All of this is logical. It makes sense. If you lay it out, we can see that this is how God might want us to be, but we live in the world, don't we? We live in spaces where chaos comes crashing around us, where we are anxious about people we love because things are not the way they should be. We are uncertain about what is happening in our world. What is the disconnect then between the logic of how this could be, how we could live, and how we are? We are promised green pastures, still waters, restoration for our souls. Why then do we live and act as if we are the ones responsible for making it happen? Why don't we let go and allow God to provide? We are assured by Jesus that all who drink of the waters that he offers will never be thirsty. How we long for this to happen, and yet we don't really want to give up that sense we have of control. In some sense, we want to believe that we are responsible, that we have some level of responsibility, that we have to make it happen. We have to drag it into being. Even though our heads tell us that God is faithful, that God has already provided what we need, we don't quite trust that it will happen. I know that's true of my life. I worry about things I am not in control of.
I obsess on things that are not mine. They belong to someone else. I fret over things that I need to get done because if I don't do it, is anybody else going to do it? And what happens if it doesn't get done today? I get discouraged when things don't go according to my plans. You see, this is where we fall short. This is where there is a disconnect, because this is where God comes beside us and whispers and says, just let it go. And we struggle because we want to trust. We want to believe all of these things. We confess with our lips and believe with our hearts that God is trustworthy, and yet, I hedge my bets. I plan for the worst. I have contingency plans and backup plans, and I brace myself for the worst that could happen, because if I plan for the worst, I'll be thrilled when the best happens. Rather than trusting and believing and letting go. Because all of this trying hard that we're doing is exhausting, isn't it? All of this racing around trying to keep the world spinning that isn't actually us doing it wears us out, and it's not God's design. God's design is to provide for us a faithful Savior, a guide, a good shepherd who longs to lead us and provide for us, and yes, give us the peace that feels so elusive. The wholeness that can't be taken away. We have to shift our focus. We have to shift our intent. We need only seek first the kingdom of God, we are told. To practice this idea of gentleness and humbleness. To practice this idea that God holds us safely. We don't just get it, right? If we could snap our fingers and have it together, we would have done that already. What we have to learn to do is to practice trusting the faithfulness of God. Day by day, sometimes minute by minute, sometimes maybe even second by second, to trust that the shepherd is with us. Together, we gather in this place every week and proclaim the promises of God. Together, then, we are sent out to tell other people about these same promises, that God longs to offer our world shalom, wholeness, peace, completeness. Amen.
Thank you.
people of God, are there joys or concerns you have to share with one another this morning? Yeah, that's a hard one. Prayers for those who loved Mike. Other things, Jenny. Darlin's family. Debbie. So Nora, loss of her brother. Mel. Permanently home, we rejoice in her retirement and well earned break from that. Debbie. Prayers for Shirley. I have a request from Diane Ciametti. Her mom is in the hospital. So prayers for Doris, but more than that, prayers for the family, because Doris is 100. And so we just love that she is 100. And Diane and Dan are in Florida right now. So prayers for the family as well as for Doris. They're checking, and so far everything's been negative. So how long they'll keep her, I don't know, but just prayers. And prayers for Katie. Katie has been in and out of the emergency room with passing out. So prayers for her as that continues to be a battle that she is fighting as they continue to try and figure out what's going on with her. Jenny. And a joy that Wanda is with us this morning. Absolutely. Anything else? Mel. Ongoing healing, absolutely. Anything else? People of God, let us pray together. Holy God, today we gather in the midst of clouds and rain, giving thanks for the water, for the earth, for the cleansing water you provide. Lord, we gather in your name to sing your praise, but also to share our heartache. We gather full of the concerns and worries of the week that has passed and the week that is to come. And Lord, this is a space where we pause and take a breath. Yet we confess that we understand and we know that you wish for us to do that regularly. That you are with us, that you call to us, that you invite us, and that even when we are not still, you are the Good Shepherd who provides for our needs. And so we give you thanks for your provision, for the shelter that we have and the food that we eat, for our friends and our families, for all the good you have provided for us, Lord, we rejoice. And we pray for those who are struggling. We pray for those who are living with uncertainty and fear. We pray for those who do not have the food, the shelter, the sense of security that we do. We pray, Lord, for people who worship in secret. We pray for communities that have been torn apart. We pray for victims of violence. We pray, Lord, for those who are grieving. We pray for Mike's family and Darlene's family and for Nora and her family. Lord, we ask for healing for those who are in need as well. We pray for Shirley. We pray for Doris and for Katie. We pray for Chris. We pray, Lord, for those that we didn't name, for those who are on our hearts and our minds, for those who we love, and for those that we do not know and yet come into our hearts. Lord God, we ask that this week we might be bearers of your peace, that we might humbly, graciously, kindly live in this world, that we might be the kind of people who shine with your grace and your love. Help us, we pray, to be bearers of your shalom, even as we learn to rest beside still waters and to allow you to refresh our souls. We trust, Lord, all of this is possible because of your Son, Jesus, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. People of God, we are going to sing together The King of Love, My Shepherd Is. It is number 802.
People of God, shepherded by the great shepherd, go in peace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit go with you from this place as you carry the shalom of God with you out into the world. And God's people say, amen.